become 2.5. And you can see that the market price of spot price was just gone up by less than 10%. But the call warrants price has gone from 1.5 to 2.5. It's more than maybe 30%, 40%. Okay? And even more. And exercise price, similar case. If the exercise price is not $10 but $9, then the intrinsic value will be increased. Let's talk about the implied volatility. Let's assume all the other things being the same, and the implied volatility, the higher the implied volatility, the higher the warrants price or the options price. Okay, let me give you an example. So the implied volatility for maybe, let's say, Hang Seng Index, for call Hang Seng Index, and the implied volatility, maybe let's say now it's about 27%. How to understand the 27%? Maybe let's start with 32%. 32% means that the annualized percentage of the market forecasting about the underlying volatility is about, per day is 2%. 32% divided by 16. This is square root of 256. 256 is the trading days of a year. So that's not important. Let me repeat. 32% means that the market forecast for the underlying price movement is about 2%. That's, just remember it. This is the important thing. So the higher the implied volatility means that you have the higher chance or higher opportunity to make the warrants become in the money. In the money, warrants will be more valuable. Okay, so if you got more chance to be a rich man, then you will be more valuable. That's the concept. Okay, so if you haven't bought the warrant, you may wish the warrants implied volatility can be go lower and lower. Then you can buy at a cheaper price. And then when you are holding the warrants, you will wish that the implied volatility go up. So the affecting factors is very important for you is the implied volatility, not just the underlying price. Underlying price, of course, is very important, but also the implied volatility. A lot of complaining phone calls to other issuers, not to us. They are asking why the warrants is not following the underlying performance. That's maybe because of the implied volatility. Change of implied volatility, okay? And for the put warrants, the concept is similar, but you have to study again. But I'm here, I'm not going to provide you more information. I'm afraid you cannot remember all of this. So I have talked about the swap price, skip this. The moneyless, I will talk about, okay. Moneyless, let's start with call warrant again. I've talked about the example, the $10 exercise price and the spot price is $11. Then this one is a call warrant with and this is in the money call warrant because the spot price is higher than the strike price. Okay, and vice versa, you for the put warrant, the strike price you will only exercise when the strike price is higher than the spot price. So when the spot price is equal to strike price, then this is called at the money call or at the money put. And for out of the money, just another case about the spot price of this. Yeah, that's right. Strike price is, if the strike price higher than the spot price, then the call warrants will become out of the money. This is the chart presentation, nothing more than that. So implied volatility, I have mentioned this part to you. And this is a market expectation of the volatility of the underlying assets. So this is one of the factors that affects the price of warrants. I think it is the second largest factor. So if you don't know, if you still do not understand the concept of implied volatility, please do not trade warrants yet. You should go further to study the concept of implied volatility. But yes. You can go ahead if you wish to make money or lose money if you still, okay. This is a good example for you. We got a Hang Seng Index call. It will be expired May of this year. And you can see that when the implied volatility is about 27%, the price of the warrant will be 0.085. But if we change the implied volatility to 35%, the warrant price will be 0.12, about 0.12. So you can tell the implied volatility can affect the price very much. Okay? So you can see that even though the underlying price still at the level of 21,400, and nothing has changed except the implied volatility. So implied volatility, as I mentioned, this is the second largest factor affecting the price of won. So you have to remember this point. You need to choose the lower IV, because a lower IV gives you two things. The lower unit price, 0.085 must be lower than the 0.12, and it gives you a greater gearing effect. If you want to make money from the war market, effective gearing is the factor you have to look at. So when you are right in the direction of the underlying, for example, the Hang Seng Index gone up by 1%, and for these two warrants, the first one will give you 9.3% of return, and the second one will give you only 7.2% return. And this is about time to maturity concept. Time to maturity, time decay, this is the third factor that affecting the price of warrants. This is always a negative factor to warrant, because whatever it gone up or gone down, or whatever other terms changed, the time decay will negative for your warrants price. So it decay like this way, exponentially, not linearly. Okay, this is another concept, but it is not a really a big factor affecting the price. So let's discuss again if you really want to know next time. This is another table showing the five factors or six factors affecting the warrant price. What I just mentioned. And the settlement. As I mentioned, warrant is a highly standardized product. So for the settlement, it is also standardized. For example, if you are we got a call warrant is going to expire this 25th, next Monday, and it will start to trade since 20th of January. The T minus 3 will be the suspension day for the warrant, or T minus 4 will be the last trading day for the warrant. So you shouldn't expect that. Why cannot trade with that warrant on 21st or 22nd? So the last trading day is T minus 4, and we will have a settlement price for every warrant. So every warrant, we will taking into account about T minus 5, T minus 5, 4, and then 3, 2, 1, the 5 days prior to expiry days, that will be taken into account to the settlement price. We will take the average closing price of these Fridays as the settlement price. So the settlement price, for example, we got the $9 exercise of a call, and then we take into account of this Friday's closing price, and then we got a final settlement price, maybe $11, and then the issuer will give you back $2, the intrinsic value. Then after the expiry date, maybe 3 days, T plus 3, you can get the money back. So you don't have to hold the warrant until the expiry, but when you make money, you can sell it, or if you want to cut loss, you can sell it. But of course, if you think the last few days of the before the expiry will be very volatile, then you can try to get into the market and buy our warrants and then wait for the settlement. Yeah, this is the concept. So warrants versus stock. Warrant has a gearing effect and stock have no leverage. So many investors, they want to trade warrants because of the leverage effect. And the limited downside, if you put maybe, you are talking about maybe if you buy 941, the China Mobile, you may need to pay 40,000 Hong Kong dollars. If you buy 941's call warrant with similar, maybe absolute return, you may just put into maybe one third of the money or even less. And you can have a long short strategy for warrant and stock. Of course, you can have long only. Of course, you can borrow the stock and short sell it, but this is not practical for individual investors.